My bandsaw doesn't cut very accurately. The blade likes to wander around or otherwise do not what I'm asking of it. And the reason for this is quite simple. The lower blade guides are missing. This bandsaw used to belong to my grandpa, and the lower blade guides are lost to time. They could be in his old wood shop, or they could very well be in a landfill. I don't know. They're gone. So what I'm going to do is make some new blade guides. I'm going to make some new blade guides for the bottom and for the top. And the reason I'm going to replace these perfectly good and existing blade guides on the top is because I'm going to take this as an opportunity to upgrade to ball bearing blade guides. And yes, I could buy them for this saw, but what fun would that be? So I'm going to make them. And I'm going to make these blade guides out of this chunk of purple heart because it's the densest hardwood I have on hand. And because it's pretty. I'm going to start with the top blade guide because it's readily visible. And the first step is naturally to remove the thing. Unrelated. This is the top blade guide I took off the bandsaw, and something I've always been curious about is the bearing that rides behind the blade. It's oriented to the side. Why is that? Intuitively, the bearing that sits behind the blade should be oriented like this, because that's how ball bearings work. But very commonly on many bandsaws, they're oriented to the side like this so that the blade rubs against the side of the ball bearing. I've always wondered why that is. If you know the answer to that question, please let me know in the comments down below. I've always been curious. On the blade guide that I make, the bearing is going to be situated this way behind the blade, because I've also seen that commonly on bandsaws, and it makes the most sense. Assuming I have the space to mount the bearing like this, that's what I'm going to do. Gooey. I need to make a couple of relief cuts around the mounting hole so the screw in there can clamp the mounting block in place on the mounting rod thing, whatever it's called, on the bandsaw. And yes, I am using another bandsaw to make a part for my bandsaw. With the mounting block, or whatever it should be called, mounted, it's time to move on to making the first of four bearing carriages. The hole I just drilled into the side of this block was supposed to be for this dowel nut here, but it doesn't fit. That's because while the packaging on this dowel nut says it's 3/8 of an inch in diameter, it's actually 10 millimeters, which is no big problem. I just have to remount this hole with a 10 millimeter drill bit, which I bought here. However, because I live in America, I had to drive around to 6 different stores before I even found one that sold metric bits at all. Finally found this one though, so I can enlarge this hole for this dowel nut. Unfortunately, drilling this hole out with my new 10 millimeter drill bit didn't quite do the trick because this dowel nut will fit in the hole now, but it fits very snugly. And I need this to be a loose fit so it can slide back and forth willy-nilly. And the reason for that is because this dowel nut is 9.98 millimeters in diameter, while this 10 millimeter drill bit that I spent all day hunting down is 9.91 millimeters in diameter. That's only a 10th of a millimeter in the difference, but it's enough to make the difference between a snug fit and a loose fit. And again, I need this to be a loose fit for reasons that will become apparent later. So what I've gone and done is I've gone out and I've purchased a complete Imperial drill bit set. And if you're not familiar with the absurdities that are Imperial drill bit sizing, prepare to get a crash course, because a complete Imperial drill bit set has 115 pieces in it. You've got your standard sizes over here from 1/16 of an inch to 1/2 of an inch in 1/64 of an inch increments. So starting at 1/16, going to 5/64, etc., all the way up to 1/2. Then back here, you have your wire gauge sizes going from a number 1 bit to a number 60 bit, 1 being the largest, 60 being the smallest. And you can see the sizes in inches just under the numbers here. And then this section over here are the lettered bits going from A to Z. It's an absurd system, and it took my head a while to wrap around this. And you may be wondering, what's the reasoning behind having all of these different sizes? And the answer is to fill the gaps between all the standard size increments for precise work like tapping holes. Because if I'm going to tap, for instance, a 5/16 inch hole, the hole I need to drill for that can't be a 5/16 inch hole, because then it would be too big and the tap would have nothing to dig into. I need a slightly undersized hole for that. And in the case of a 5/16 inch hole, I need a letter F drill bit to drill the hole for a 5/16 inch threaded hole. And that's what most of these number and letter bits are for. But what I have it for in this exact one case is I need a drill bit. Where'd my dowel nut go? There it is. I need a drill bit to drill a hole that is slightly larger than the diameter of my dowel nut. And the diameter of my dowel nut is 0.395 inches. So if I reference this chart that came with my drill bit set, I know that I need a letter X drill bit, which is 0.397 inches in diameter. So I'm going to take this letter X drill bit over here and re-bore this hole, and then hopefully my dowel nut will fit in here and slide nicely into this hole and not be a snug fit. And that did the trick. After using the letter X drill bit, this dowel nut not only fits in the hole, but it slides freely, which is exactly what I wanted. Now to finish shaping the carriage on the table saw and drill press. Now you can see how this whole piece goes together. In the middle of these two bearings, sort of joining the two, is a small bronze spacer with an outer diameter of the inner diameter of the bearing and an inner diameter of the outer diameter of this screw. I'm using these brass spacers so I can use these bearings that I had on hand. And to cut the spacers to length, I just used an unnecessary assortment of power tools. This thumb screw fits through the middle here. These two conjoined bearings, a washer goes here, and then this thumb screw screws into the dowel nut that has been placed in this hole. And the slot in the front is so the bearings can be unscrewed and adjusted side to side as needed. And that is the side to side blade carrier assembly. To mount this carriage to the mounting block, I just need to carve a shallow groove in the bottom of the mounting block on the table saw. Then I can cut a slot into the carriage on the drill press with the world's dullest Forstner bit. This carriage slots into the main block into that slot I cut into the table saw earlier to slide back and forth, and it's going to be held in place by a screw that goes through this slot. Now, I need to drill and tap a hole directly into the purple heart, and it's a 1/4-20-inch screw, so that means I need a number 7 drill bit to drill the hole so I can tap it. And here's my 1/4-20 tap. Seems to work just fine. I've never tapped a hole directly into wood before. Seems to work great. Here's the upper blade guide as it exists so far. The only problem I'd see is that this thumb screw down here, this wing bolt to adjust the ins and outs of this lower carriage here, sticks down a little bit too far. I might have to replace that with a non-wing bolt, just a regular screw, so it has more clearance underneath. That would have the downside of requiring tools to do any adjustments, but I could just keep an Allen wrench or whatever it is nearby. All right, now let's make the bearing holder for the back of the blade. Quarter 20 tap. Take the thumb screw, which is really too long, and it's unnecessary to have a thumb screw, but it'll work, so why not? And thread it into this arm, and that will be my thrust bearing. I might put a little dab of CA glue between the bearing and the brass spacer there to keep it from moving around, but it's a pretty tight fit, so I don't think I'll need to. Now to drill a slot into this arm so I can mount it to the main base. And now, power tool safety with Robert. This piece should just fit right on here. This thumb screw should thread right in. Here it is in place. One minor little issue is that there's barely any clearance between this piece of wood and this bearing, but that's no problem at all. I can just shave that off with a knife. Just a protruding corner there. And this slot I barely made long enough. It's all the way out, but since this is a 1/4-inch blade, and I think that's as far out as it'll ever need to go, I think that's fine. Anyway, there's no lower blade guide yet, but I want to make a test cut because I'm excited about this. So let's turn on the dust collector and turn on the bandsaw and make a test cut. That's the most control I've ever had on any cut on this bandsaw. So far, I'm very pleased with this. Now to make the lower blade guides. And just like I said, ain't no blade guide down here. Now the block that holds the blade guides is still down here, but that doesn't do much good on its own. I could try to reuse this block, but making a hexagonal shaped rod out of wood would be difficult, so I'm just gonna make the whole thing up from scratch. I'm not sure the purpose this little plate serves, but it keeps some of the dust from getting down into this lower dust port here, so I may leave this off, unless I figure out that it has some sort of higher safety purpose. To replace this mount block, I just glued up this purple heart block here, and now all I need to do is trim it down on the table saw so it's roughly the same shape and size as this block, including having a flange to mount it with. Did I mention my Forstner bit isn't very sharp? Because it's not. That's good. Now to make the blade guide carriages. This lower blade guide is going to be a lot more difficult to make than the upper blade guide because it's so much closer to the blade here. This is a 1/4-inch blade. It's about as far forward as I need to go, and still there's less than an inch of clearance between this blade and this block. Putting the thrust bearing in here behind the blade is going to be no problem because I can just push it back as far as I want and then make clearance in this block if I need to. But the side bearings down here are going to be an issue because this section here that sort of has to go in the front of the block is already more than an inch wide, and there's less than an inch between this block and this blade here. So I'm gonna have to think on this a little bit. I've had a bit of a think about it, and what I've decided is this mounting block isn't going to work for me like I thought it was going to. So I've made a new one. And as you can see, it's pretty much like the old one. It just has a higher flange and a cutout in the bottom for it. And that cutout on the bottom is for this piece of wood, which is going to be the bearing carriage for the side load bearings that press on the side of the blade. And the reason I needed this cutout to be so wide and all the way on the bottom is because this entire carriage, including the bit with the slide adjust dowel nuts in them, needs to fit into this mounting block because this mounting block is a lot closer to the blade than the upper mounting block. So that's why I chose this new design. And the thrust bearing will go up here in a slot or something. I don't know, I just had to make sure that I had room and nothing would foul when the table was in place and all the way tilted. So this is what I came up with. Now to make that bearing carriage, starting with Power Tool Safety with Robert, Part 2. I hate everything. Thank you. crap. My drill press gone and broke on me. I think the spring just came out of adjustment. Oh yeah. This thing vibrates so much that every nut on it gets loose over time. There's a slot across this bolt here and that nut is just gonna vibrate off again. There's something missing. I don't know if there was a cotter pin or what that was across there keeping that nut in place, but that's definitely gonna break again. My light died. Everything's breaking today. It's a new day and I have fixed this drill press with a zip tie. It'll keep that nut from backing off. At least until I can replace this drill press, which I want to do because I don't like it very much. This is not my preferred way of cutting slots into wood, but managing a piece this small on the router table would be rather dangerous. I could set up a jig to make it safe, but it's much faster to just remount the slot on the drill press. Now to drill and tap a hole in the mounting block for the carriage to screw to using a number 7 drill bit. And there we go, that part is done. If I unscrew this wing bolt here, I can adjust it forward and back. It's not very smooth. I may need to clean up that slot a little bit. Then tighten it down, and just like the upper blade guide, I can unscrew these thumb screws here to adjust the bearing side by side, thanks to the barrel nut, dowel nut, whatever it's called. Now let's work on the thrust bearing that'll slot right on the side here. And then probably I'll trim off the top of this whole mounting block because it's unnecessarily tall. Now this fits in place, but the bearing is shoved against the mounting block. So I need to carve a little recess in the mounting block here for this bearing to recess into it. That's much better. I took these blade guides apart, knocked off all the sharp corners using some sanding, and gave everything 2 coats of polyurethane, and now they're done! And not only do the blade guides exist, but they have ball bearings, they're fully adjustable, and they're fully adjustable without the use of tools. I used wing bolts or thumb screws, so I don't need to break out a wrench or an Allen wrench or anything to make adjustments on this, which is very convenient. Plus, I made them myself, so I get a warm and fuzzy feeling every time I use this bandsaw, knowing that I made this little part. This is so much better than it used to be. I did forget something in this, and I didn't remember it till just a little bit ago. I forgot to put away to mount this blade guard that goes up in here. So it's not there right now. If I get bored in the future, maybe I'll figure out a way to mount this, but I don't feel like it right now. So right now, it's gonna go without this blade guard that goes right here. Whoops! So that's it. I upgraded my bandsaw with ball bearing blade guides that were homemade, and I'm super thrilled about it. This thing has never, ever cut better. I didn't think it was possible for this bandsaw to cut so well, and now it does, so I'm super thrilled. Thank you for watching. I'll see you next time.